Hi, good morning. I'm Michael Herbst, or MFH, whatever you want. And here I'm today at this nice little place in Darmstadt to talk about pitfalls for performance and why latency numbers and typical really matter. So let me maybe, before I introduce myself a little bit and what I do and how this whole talk came about and how I really deal with all these topics, let me first of all ask you, who of you has some familiarity with like linear algebra in general? Because that's kind of what the talk is going to be about. Sounds good. Who has no clue what a matrix multiplication is? Yeah, that's perfect. Great. So, yeah. Because I was not too sure what audience to expect, but anyway, we will certainly make our way. So yeah, first I'm going to talk about a bit about my background, as I said, so what I really do every day. Then I'm going to talk about the major aspect of this talk, like what are latency numbers, what are the typical latency numbers in hardware, and what are some sort of consequences that arise from this. And so then I basically give you a hint at what I call contraction-based methods as some way to really code linear algebra to really make use of some of the conclusions we will draw from these latency numbers. Give you a few examples, some hints, some ideas, and basically how I tackle this problem in my everyday work. So let's start with what I do. So I am a theoretical chemist. I do electronic structure theory. That means with molecules, I don't know, any kind of complex chemical systems, material science, the electrons in there are really important for understanding what happens to matter. And that's kind of the stuff I really model every day. It's not really the subject of this talk, but the point is, in order to be able to do that, what you fundamentally need to understand is quantum physics. That's really the basis of it all. And quantum physics, on the other hand, is really about linear operators and their effect on functions, right? So basically, it's all about these type of things. And basically, an operator is nothing else than a matrix, right? Table of numbers. Because as you might know, matrix has all kinds of nice properties like linearity and so on and so forth. So yeah, and essentially, a function is just a vector. So in some sense, you can think about quantum physics as representing your problem in these kind of data structures and then using standard methods of linear algebra to understand what the proper, like what these kind of things, what kind of structure they have. And one very important aspect of this is diagonalization. So really finding the eigenvectors of a matrix that are so special that they just reduce to scaling, right? That there's no change in the orientation, that there's just a change in scale, which is induced by this matrix here. That's really the one fundamental problem in all kinds of quantum physics and simulating quantum physics and quantum chemistry. And that's pretty much what this talk is about, like making this type of problem efficient and dealing with like modern hardware trends with respect to this problem. It's kind of the scene that we have today. So just a quick reminder of, nevertheless, matrix products and vector products. I thought I would be quite instructive. So in general, what you do here is you have a matrix. You have one row of a matrix multiplied with the column of the vector, and you get an element in the result here. And the same for the matrix product. You have one row of the matrix here, one column of the matrix here, and this gives you, you multiply them together, sum them all up, and that gives you this entry here. Okay? So I hope this is clear to everyone. If not, please ask, because we might probably need a little bit of an understanding of this in the future of the talk. Sounds good. So let me first see, what is the, like, if you don't play any tricks, what's the scaling, the computational scaling of this type of problem here, right? So let's say the matrix is just square, n by n, and the vector is n as well. What would be the scaling of this? Just anyone who has an idea here? Yeah? Exactly. So it would be quadratic, right? N squared. And for the matrix multiplication, I guess now it's pretty clear. That's just, yeah, exactly, right? So basically, these are the typical scalings you have in these type of problems. So why is this important? Essentially, the trick of what I'm going to show you in the end boils down to finding ways to reduce the scaling here. So these are the theoretical maxima, and then when you really are able to exploit some certain aspects of the structure of these matrices that goes together with the latencies as well, then you can get that scaling down. And that's really a fundamental aspect. So when we talk about diagonalization in general, there are two different types of classes. One are the dense methods. It doesn't really matter that much what really happens in the background. The point about dense methods is that you take the memory of the matrix as a given and you directly operate on it to in the end, get your eigenpairs, you get your eigenvalues and your eigenvectors. On the contrary, you have iterative methods where you essentially you take the matrix as a given object and then you find some sort of a subspace of your whole vector space in which you can solve your problem more easily. The advantage of these type of problems is that the matrix by itself doesn't really matter that much. It's only about the effect of taking the matrix and multiplying with a vector. So the nice thing about this is that for the iterative methods, in fact, as we will see in just a second, matrices can really be large and they can have structure and you can exploit that structure. To give you a bit of an idea why this is really important for quantum chemistry, let's talk about the typical problem size that happens in quantum chemistry. So, I mean, these acronyms probably don't mean much to you. It doesn't really matter for that point. Let me just say that this full CI, FCI thingy is a very, very accurate quantum chemical method. This is a medium to small, actually rather small, model to represent this method. And even in the small representation, you have a dimensionality which is on the order of 10,000. And this means that you have 2 times 10 to the 9 number of matrix elements. So even though this is only such a small basis, a small, very crude approximation to this method is already a very huge matrix. And there, it's just not possible to do it in dense methods. Because for dense methods, you would really need to put that whole thing in memory and work on it in memory. And that's just, I mean, it typically is not possible. So what you do instead is you need to write it on the hard drive. Because there's no other way you can do this if you're employing dense methods. And then it, of course, gets pretty slow, as you can probably imagine. So the problem is that since you have these huge problem sizes, you really need to find ways to express or to work with diagonalization methods without putting the whole thing in memory. Like as soon as you need to store it somewhere, you're basically done. It will be slow. And this is just one way to do it. You have also other types of quantum chemistry methods where the dimensionality can even go up to something like a million. So really, it's no real point to store it. So that's just kind of the motivation for it all. Let's just look at some timings to get a feeling how dense methods versus iterative methods kind of perform in general. For this, I've chosen a very simple test problem. It doesn't really matter what the physics is. Essentially, a discretized Laplace operator in a 1D case. And what happens is that you have this tri-diagonal structure here, where you have -2s along the diagonal and 1 along the sub-diagonals here. All right? And it's a very simple structure, but let's say we don't know about the structure, right? Let's say we want to be general for some reason and we don't want to know about the structure from the point of view of the diagonalization algorithm. So, I mean, surely putting it all in memory, storing all the zeros is a stupid idea, but let's just see what happens if we still do it. Okay, so here I have some Julia script. One is a very naive implementation of this Laplace operator. So if you just compare, it was -2s along the diagonal and 1s along the subdiagonals. That's pretty much what this says. So this builds the full matrix in memory. On the other hand, we have methods which are the so-called contraction-based methods that I'll go into in the second half of the talk. And here we don't really put the memory, we don't really allocate the memory. But instead what we do is we have a vector which goes in and a vector which goes out here, right? And inside this function, we just use the knowledge of the structure of the matrix. Here's the -2, and the 1 is kind of hidden here. And we just mimic the application of the matrix to the vector which comes in. So this is kind of a single loop which does the matrix vector product, okay? Just written out. And then we need to play some more tricks, but anyway, that's kind of the setup. Let's just run it to get a feeling for what happens. For a comparatively small problem size, like 40, it takes a bit to compile because Julia scripts get compiled, and there we are. And you see the full diagonalization, i.e. putting the whole thing in memory using this naive function and diagonalizing afterwards, takes about a small number of time. I don't know, 0.7 milliseconds, but the contraction here already takes only 0.4 milliseconds. If I, however, I go to smaller problem sizes, you'll find that that in fact the full diagonalization is a bit faster, right? So I mean, here you see it should be, yeah, I mean it's just barely. I mean these problems are not that great because they're actually really simple. But for standard problems, for like actual problems, you will always find, or you will typically find, that the full type of diagonalization is okay for small problem sizes, and that the contraction-based diagonalization is faster for large problem sizes. So if we actually plot some sort of a graph here, basically we go from very small problem sizes to very large ones, you can clearly see that there's a difference in the computational scaling. So the time is plotted in blue in each case. The time is plotted in the solid lines in each case, and the memory usage is plotted in the dashed lines in each case. And you see that between the full, which is the blue curves, and the orange ones, which was the contraction-based ansatz, you can clearly see that there's a connection between the scaling in memory and the scaling in time, right? And the essential advantage of this contraction-based algorithm is that you don't need that much memory, and you can better exploit the structure of such matrices in order to keep the scaling down. And that's really the overall idea behind these contraction-based methods in the end. Avoiding memory and using the structure of the matrices implicitly in order to tackle this type of scaling. Okay. So, I mean, in this case, tridiagonal matrix, it's kind of clear what the structure really is. But, I mean, typical problems in reality are a bit more complicated. So this, for example, is some kind of matrices which arise in some kinds of quantum chemistry. I don't want to go into details. You can ask if you want to know about this later. You see, it's not that simple to see a structure, right? So there, you need to work on it a bit harder. And I mean, you might have seen in comparison this expression here to really do build the full thing in memory versus the expression here to do the application. I mean, there's a clear difference in complexity from the point of view of coding it. And this is only half the truth, because in order to get this contraction-based algorithm fast, you also need to play something called shift and invert. In case you know about this, it's like some numerical technique to solve the eigenproblem. So you actually need to code the inverse of the whole thing as well, which implies actually another iterative solver in between. And you know, for this, you need a preconditioner and blah. So you know, it's not just one function to put in the memory and then hand it over to the diagonalizer to solve it, but you need to kind of build a full orchestra of things which work together. So it's a bit more complicated. That's the point here. And especially when the matrix structure is not so obvious, those things add up and make it not so simple in the end. All right, let's talk about latencies. So nowadays, when you actually access the cache of your CPU, that takes typically about something like 10 flops, right? I mean, so this is you can read up where I got the data from and where I worked this out. This is not such a recent CPU, something like 3.2 gigahertz, I assumed, when making these calculations. And you see, L2, L1 cache is kind of okay, right? There, accessing there, it's not that many computation that you can do at the same time. However, already at the level of main memory, where you have a latency of something like 100 nanoseconds, you can do thousands of operations, right? What this means is when it takes you, like imagine you have a bunch of data. If it takes you less than 3,000 instructions to recompute the data, it might actually be cheaper to recompute it than to fetch it from memory. So this typical paradigm, which I find in scientific software to basically calculate something and then store it, it's not generally true anymore, right? So if you have something which is simple, or where you only need very little data to compute something comparatively large, right, like a large matrix which you can approximate by a small internal structure, let's say, then maybe it's actually better to go ahead and compute the full and recompute it each time you need it in your instruction, right? And just for comparison, in an SSD read actually implies something like 10,000 instructions. And an HDD read is actually in the order of, well, yeah, quite a lot more, 10 to the 8, right? So in that sense, it really kind of gives you an idea of how much instructions, how many computations you can do. One should really mention here that this assumes what I call perfect pipelining. So it means that you really use your vectorization, you use up all the cache, you use cleverly the cache lines in the CPU and so on and so forth. So the point about this is that if you want to go towards contraction-based methods and kind of get away from the idea of memory, you always need to work very hard on your algorithms. So it's not as simple as just multiplying it. You really need to think about how to do it with the cache lines. So that is again in line with the idea that it makes things more complicated. But as we saw in this graph here, it can actually reduce the scaling even in some cases, right? So there is some real performance that you can be gained. Let's look at future trends. So this is the scale-up of CPU clock speed and the scale-up of memory bus speed over the years. And you can really see that the trends here are in favor of going towards CPU, right? Because CPUs have actually become much faster than memory has become, right? So, yeah, and I mean, this, by the way, is when people started realizing this and implemented more levels of cache. So then it was kind of dampening a bit. So if we wouldn't have gone for level 3 and, I don't know, cache, probably the improvement was like that. I don't know. But, yeah, so you see, nevertheless, the trend is a bit faster improvement here than there. So the observations we have made here with respect to the number of flops you can do for a particular main memory access, that's only going to get more over the years. So basically, our conclusion from this is that the trends is towards aiming for computation. And surely avoiding hard drives and SSDs is something you probably want to do. But main memory is also something which slowly and steadily will probably become a bit of an obstacle, right? So the idea is to really try and design algorithms where memory is avoided and where in the end it's about doing the computation rather than doing the storage. And in the end, historically everything, like this whole idea of contraction-based methods was motivated by avoiding disk. But you can really think about the whole thing now to take it one step further and try to avoid main memory as well. But as I said, code becomes a bit more complicated in general. All right, let's look at contraction-based methods. So as I said, most important algorithms in linear algebra, that is diagonalization methods, but that is also the typical linear solvers, there you don't really need the matrix. You only need to be able to multiply the matrix with a vector. So, I mean, we just avoid A completely. That's the idea. You saw it in the code. I didn't really build the matrix and then applied it to a vector. Much rather, I coded the result of this application directly. And this is the idea of contraction-based methods, to focus on coding an expression to do the matrix vector product or something more complicated, as we'll see. So the advantages are less storage. Well, that's kind of obvious by now, I guess. But also easier parallelization. Why is that? If you have less storage, that means less communication between workers. And that means it's easier to parallelize. Because if every worker can kind of bootstrap the data by himself by computing it, you don't need to care about getting it everywhere in sync, right? It's just recomputed in time when it's needed. And also something which is quite important, as we'll see in a second, there is a bit more freedom to really exploit the structure of the matrices in contraction-based methods, right? And the structure of the matrix in the end is also hidden, right? Because from the point of view of the algorithm, which does the diagonalization or the linear solve, it's just some way to multiply the matrix with a vector. It doesn't really know what's the structure of the matrix. It doesn't really know what tricks are played down under the hood. And that's really nice because it allows you to modularize your code, right? It allows you to, on the one hand, have this highly specific, well-tuned, cache reusing and, I don't know, vectorization improved version of doing the contraction. But on the other hand, you have your algorithm to do the iterative solves. And these two don't need to know from another. In other words, if a physicist who doesn't know about the vectorization stuff codes an algorithm, he can do that. And he can only think about doing these matrix vector products. But he doesn't need to actually code them. Right? But on the other hand, where really the computational bottleneck is, where these matrix vector products are executed, that's something which somebody can do that knows very well the hardware structure. And taking this even one step further, you can potentially even have multiple versions of this matrix vector product for different types of hardware. Or taking it yet one step further, you can probably even compile it in time for the particular machine and the particular cache size and whatsoever. Right, so there's really a lot of flexibility coming from this idea of this contraction-based methods. And historically, it's the hard drive, but now really we're getting it a bit, like the idea of this is to take it a bit broader, really. Let's look at some examples also, like some typical use cases which actually happen in my research quite a bit. So one would be that the matrix that you want to diagonalize, like this A, can actually be factorized in a rather long matrix, a small core, let's say, and a rather, well, actually this would be long, and I don't know what would be this, maybe broad, a broad matrix, right? So the idea is that the rank, or the size of this is n squared, but the left-hand side, this guy, and the right-hand side, this guy, they only have 2 to the n elements, okay? Just rough, I mean, in this case, just an example, of course. So, I mean, building A fully, just building it and putting it in memory, that's at least an n squared operation, right? Because we need to evaluate it all. But if I don't build it, I just keep those guys in memory, I have 2 to the n times 2 plus this, which doesn't really matter. So it's just having this factorization and thinking about A not as a matrix, but as this factorization, that already reduces the memory. Just keeping the factorization in place. And also applying it is also reducing the scaling. Right? So if we just talked about this before, if I apply this matrix A to a vector, it's On squared. Right? But if I apply the R to a vector, it's 2 to the n. Okay? And then the result will actually be a vector of size 2. So this will be, roughly speaking, constant. And this application here will also be constant. Sorry, that's not true. It will actually be 2 to the n. Okay? So the application of this guy to a vector on the right-hand side is 2 to the n. And the application of this guy to a vector on the right is also 2 to the n. So if I really think about this in this factorization, I also reduce the scaling of the computational time. So both the memory and the computational time. All right? And the point is that these type of structures are actually, well, first of all, they occur naturally sometimes, but you can also do this artificially, and that's called a low rank reduction. So actually, there are algorithms which allow you to take a matrix, or take actually even, some sort of an expression for this matrix, and compute this type of factorization. Problem is, however, that these guys, they might not be physical. Especially if you do this low rank approximation, you just get them out as a result of your algorithm, and you might not really have a physical understanding for them, and that makes them hard to understand, right? Whereas this here might really be associated to some physics. It might be like describing the kinetic energy or something. The low rank approximation you compute, that might be just something, right? Just values which come out. So again, thinking about this as like the one thing that is done by some computer scientists, maybe, or somebody who programs the algorithms, and the other thing done by someone who does code the applications and the physical model. This is really, I mean, this is the low end, and this is the high end. So you really have some way to separate these two levels and to give each of the people their respective nice way of thinking about it, right? So in a contraction-based ansatz, somebody on the upper level would just see this, but it would actually be hidden inside this contraction expression, it would be that. That's the overall idea, right? So the people on the up, they don't see the unphysical bit, but the people on the low end, they can work with it. And actually, thinking about low-rank approximations in physics, there's a clear connection between low rank or long rank structures and symmetries. So essentially, whenever you have symmetries in your physical system, that can be expressed by reducing this rank in this type of factorization. And you can exploit this explicitly. So if you study the symmetries of your problem, you can find these. And you can really work on contraction schemes very hard and think about how to do it. And this is something which can be done, but it's of course something you need to do explicitly. This is typically a bit, yeah, it helps you because you have some physical insight that you can put into your problem, but you can also do it implicitly. That's by actually just calling some standard algorithms to do it. And these type of factorizations are actually systematically improvable because you can give them some sort of a truncation tolerance, right? And that's quite nice because it allows you to find symmetries, like implicit symmetries, which are really hard to find explicitly. right? So that's why these low rank structures are actually so important, because you can, in some sense, you can, as a physicist who doesn't yet know about his problem, you can still write efficient code, because you just call the factorization functions, and in the end, they do the work, and they give you this nice low rank structure. Yeah? All right, let's go to some what I call more realistic cases. So, I mean, the type of factorization I showed was just matrix factorizations. However, the problem is that in many physical applications, you have a bit more generalized structures called tensors, right? So if you think about a matrix just as a function f of x, which is just multiplying the matrix with such a vector, okay. So one example would be that you have this multi-index object here, right? It's now not a table in two dimensions, but in four dimensions, and you contract now over this matrix, okay? So now, doing this, you get a matrix out of a different matrix. But actually, it can be even more complicated. So for example, you can have intermediate matrices which are contracted together. And of course, you can also apply this whole thing to a vector, and then you get this nice expression here, okay? So this is really a multiple sum over multi-indexed objects. And this, in fact, this expression as you see it is something which occurs in my code. So this is really stuff which happens in practice. And what's the point about this? Now, if I really build first this matrix, okay? I first evaluate this full expression here, and then at a later step in my iterative solver, for example, I contract it to a vector. That's one way of doing it. And the other way of doing it is directly evaluating the full expression at once. What are the advantages of the second case? The second case is I can actually reorder terms, right? Because nobody tells me here in which order I do the summation, right? For example, this summation with j, I don't necessarily need to do last. I could do it first. Where in this case, where I first build the matrix and then contract it, I always have to do it last. Right? So this allows me to reorder these contractions. And if there's some symmetries in these indices, meaning that you for example, cannot have all values of I when for each value of j, right? So it could happen that if I choose j and b, for example, some values of I are implicitly included by some symmetries in my physical problem. That's actually, again, a realistic use case that I have in my code. So there, if you can reorder the terms, it allows you to exploit some of these, I call index selection rules, okay? Because if you contract with the j first, then some of the values of this I are kind of already forbidden, right? So this helps you to avoid some of the I, okay? And you can think of this a bit like a matrix N, this N which comes out of here like a matrix with state, right? Because the C's are the state, right? So this would be the case where you actually build the full thing in memory densely. And this would be the case where you have this contraction-based ansatz where you really have an expression, because this is now an expression for doing the matrix vector product. So what I just explained with reordering the terms and exploiting the symmetries, that's only really possible to a full extent when you think about this whole thing as an expression. And some people of you who know a bit more about programming language theory might have already thought, "Ha, this sounds like lazy evaluation." And actually, that's exactly what it is. So if we really want to combine ideas, like basically this idea of factorization and this idea of what I just explained with the term reordering, things become actually very difficult. But one way to tackle it is to do lazy evaluation, right? Okay, so what I want to summarize here with this is really to think about, as you add up more things and as you combine stuff, it really gets more complicated, and lazy evaluation as motivated from this term reordering allows you to collect an expression, it allows you to build up an expression from physically motivated building blocks, and then in the end, you can work on it only when you need it inside an iterative solver. And one thing which I also hinted at already, the optimization of such a lazy expression tree, that is not necessarily needed to be hard-coded, right? You can actually work on the optimization strategies depending on the hardware you have, for example. And the code on the upper level, right, the actual code which deals with the linear algebra, for example, that is independent from the evaluation scheme, right? Because the linear algebra code just sees the matrix vector product. So there's a bit of potential for modularization again. All right, so what are lazy matrices? That's kind of taking this idea of lazy evaluation into a matrix structure again. Why is this nice and why is this necessary in my opinion? Well, stored matrices are the thing that we typically have, right? Where everything is stored in memory. But lazy matrices, there you can actually think about them as a contraction expression which is dressed like a matrix. So why do I think this is actually quite nice? Well, the point is that matrices are, from a physical point of view, quite tractable, right? You can just get elements, you can look at them, you can plot them, you can probably associate, or actually in many cases you can associate them with an actual physical quantity, whereas expressions, as I just said, they're a bit fishy and something's complicated, and I mean, the better and the more performant you want to make them, the more complicated they typically get. Right, so the idea of lazy matrices is to give physicists, people on the upper end, something they know, something they can understand, but people on the lower end, they can still do all their stuff in the expressions and optimize them as necessary. And this idea of matrices with state that we had with the tensor expression a few slides back, that can also be incorporated in lazy matrices, because essentially it's nothing else than just telling such a tree, such an expression tree to, hey, update part of your matrices. Right, so it's really some sort of a generalization which fits well to the needs that I typically had in my problems. Yeah. All right. So let's look briefly at evaluation in the sense of lazy matrices. So that would be an example where you add two matrices, then you multiply with a third one, and in the end, this is really inside your iterative solver, for example. There you would do this application to a vector. So first, you just add. It's lazy, so it doesn't do any work. So this is no computation. It just builds a tree, right? Where it says, this is to be added. Then the next thing is you multiply with the matrix C. That's again just taking the tree, multiplying, and building a bigger tree. And only right here in the very end, when you do the matrix vector product in your iterative solver, this is when the application is done. And here you could, for example, optimize the tree. That's the whole point. You can optimize the tree depending on hardware and all sorts of aspects. You can maybe find redundant expressions and so on. I mean, this is a solved problem, because everybody who like works in compiler building, for example, this is just a DAG, right? This is a directed acyclic graph, and you can work on it with standard graph theory methods and then simplify your expression here, right? So people on the physics, they would code this. They would know nothing about what's happening in the back. And people who are working on the low level, they would really work on this aspect, and they would work on the expressions that sit inside the matrices A, B, and C. Because this whole thing here can actually be thought of as one matrix vector product of C to X, then one of B with the result, one of A with the result, and adding it all up. Right? So this can really be, this whole thing can really be written in terms of matrix vector products. So this is really the idea. I mean, if you have multiple of these lazy matrix terms, each of the terms implements its own contractions, and each of the terms can do optimization of these contraction expressions relevant to the particular type of structure of the matrices they represent, or of the, for example, type of hardware which is available. And on the evaluation, you can optimize the tree. And each of the terms can have a physical interpretation, right? So it's tractable for people who understand the physics. And it's in fact really a building block for building more complicated expressions. And something which is really transparent to the end user. You can just add a new matrix term, you can just add a new physical modeling if you make it more refined. And yeah, algorithms which are working with these expressions are also independent, right? Because they don't necessarily see anything of the matrix structure. They only see the matrix vector product. Yeah, just as a takeaway, I think I explained to you that memory is not generally faster than computation. It's something which really needs to be balanced. Lazy evaluation is quite a nice concept. It really allows to exploit all the aspects I introduced. Term reordering, factorization, and these index type selection rules, which are quite common in physical modelings. In the end, it allows you to really streamline the whole application, the whole operation, and really work on the streamline. Depending on your architecture, depending on your hardware, depending on what you have in mind. And the whole thing is kind of transparent, especially from the end user point of view. It looks as if you're still dealing with matrices. So that's in my opinion, something which is quite nice about the idea of lazy matrices. Yeah, and if you want to read a little bit more, actually, all of this is really with quantum chemistry as the application in mind. But if you want, you can read my thesis or this paper, which we recently brought out. And other than that, I thank you very much for being here today. And I look forward to your questions. Yeah, please. You mean, yeah. So let me do one question at a time. So the first question was, what about the outputs, right? You have outputs in the whole idea of lazy matrices as well. They have to be represented, and they have to be represented in dense form. That's what you're asking. What about them? Sorry, you have to? Actually, you don't. And the reason is. Well, so the point is, if you convert a matrix in order to look at it, yes, then you have to convert it back into dense form, and then you have memory problems. But the point about contraction-based methods is that all methods of linear algebra that are relevant in the sense of all methods, all typical problems you have in linear algebra, that being linear solving linear systems, singular value decomposition, eigenproblems, you know, and a few more. All of these can be expressed solely by doing matrix vector products. For all of these type of standard problems, there are algorithms available which only need to multiply the matrix with a vector, with an arbitrary vector, sure, but with a vector. And the outcome of this is only of the size of vector. So if you have a memory problem for storing the matrix, but not a memory problem for storing the vectors, then this works. If you also have a memory problem for storing the vectors, then you can start distributing the vectors, right? Which in this formalism is not still not easy, I should say, but it's easy, yeah, because the idea is that you have less data to really synchronize between the different nodes working on it, because they locally can actually compute part of the data, right? That's the whole idea. So it's, yeah, sure, if you want the matrix, still a problem. But if you're only interested about the vectors and you can in practice, then it's okay. Yes, second question? Entropy in what sense? In the computational, in the sense of computer science, essentially? Like information content? Okay, so the question was whether using this idea of decomposing matrices reduces the overall entropy of the particular matrix that you're looking at. Is that right? Yes. So the point is that in mathematics, you have this concept called a rank. So you can actually associate to a matrix a rank, which is essentially the number of columns or rows that you need to have in order to unambiguously describe the matrix. So, I mean, roughly speaking, I mean, it's not exactly mathematically right. And the point is that this is a given quantity, and these low rank factorizations only allow you to kind of uncover this value, sometimes in an approximate sense. So, let's say you have a big difference in the relevance of certain of these special columns, let's say. Some of them are very important, some of them less important. And if you only do it approximately, you can leave them out, Right? So that would be one way to doing these factorizations. In that sense, you're losing entropy, sure, but you're only losing a very little bit because those vectors are not important. If you want to know more about this, come and ask me later. I can tell you some algorithms and some ways to do this. It's all about the idea that your original matrix already has less entropy than you thought it did. Right? This is also to do with this idea of symmetries which are present in your problem. So it's all kind of related. But yeah, it's some idea of entropy is in this. Very true. Yeah, please. Yeah. Yeah.
This is actually something which at least I do very often, not in the sense of computing, but whenever I program, I find values in some variable. Because I always thought that's faster.
Yeah.
You said probably when I use the cache, it still is faster, only if I go to main memory.
Yeah. So to be fair with you, I don't know much about compilers. So I can only tell you that probably there are some ways to do it. I mean, sure, you have all sorts of I think the guy in the back knows. Oh, I should also repeat. Yeah. Yeah, so the question was about cache reuse, essentially, and how can I find whether a variable is stored in cache? And the answer was that Valgrind has a cache profiler, essentially. just summing it up briefly. Okay. Further questions? Yeah, please. Mm-hmm. The honest answer is it will very much depend on your hardware. So I don't know enough about this to give you a rule of thumb, to be fair. In general, what you can do, however, is you can, for example, if you have multiple cores on your machine, you can start using more and more and more. And if you have an unnatural scale up, right? So typically, if you double your cores, but your performance increases by more than 200%, more than double, whatever that is in percent anyway, but 100%, yeah. So if it increases more than it should by doubling the cores, that's an indication that all of a sudden your whole problem fits in cache and all of a sudden you don't need to go to main memory anymore. So that would be one way that I use to find it out, right? But in general, yeah, I'm sorry, I can't really say much about this. Again, I think tools like Valgrind might be helpful there, but yeah. Sorry, did I take a look at? LibEigen. Yeah, I did. So Eigen uses some magic in the templates, especially, to do these things. The problem with this is that it's compile time, and it's typically done well before execution, in the sense of it's part of your C++ program, you compile it, and then it's fixed forever. But this is not what I had in mind when I started working on these lazy matrices. What I had in mind was really you run it on your laptop, it on the fly compiles for your laptop, then you run the same code without like recompiling it all on, let's say, a different machine, and it compiles the computational intense kernels for your machine. And actually, there's software which does this. So, I mean, this is not something that I would have to write. In fact, like, there's a project in Copenhagen called Borium, for example. They do JIT compilation on top of Python. That's quite cool. And I mean, for example, many programming languages, like, for example, Julia, they also work by this idea of really JIT compiling before you, just in time compiling before you run the whole thing. That's really the idea I had in mind with these lazy matrices. And well, an eigen goes a different idea, goes along a different idea. It thinks about compiling it once and then keeping it. Which has a few disadvantages. Of course, also advantages because you don't need to recompile each time. But yeah, so I guess the sweet spot is just different. And there was another question. You mean something like, so the question was whether in the future compilers might be aware of index symmetries and exploiting these index selection rules when doing expressions. Maybe compilers is pushing it a bit too far, but maybe some sort of a pre-compiler might be aware of this. So I think quite highly of this concept of JIT compilation, because especially in dynamic languages like Python or Julia, for example, you can actually interfere with this a little bit. So perhaps you can actually help the compiler by pushing it into the right direction, so to speak, with like by telling it in some convention, these index conventions, and allowing to unroll loops and things like that in a clever way. I guess something like this can be done. Yeah, I think that's also quite a good project in theory. But I mean, that's a quite a good idea for research. In fact, we thought about that. But whether like an actual compiler just off the shelf can do it, I'm not too sure about that, because it's highly problem specific. It's highly specific to what your indices mean, so to speak. I'm not sure how you could tell a compiler in a very abstract sense something about these indices, which be uniform throughout the program and things like that. I guess that's a bit more complicated. Yeah. More questions? All right. Then thank you again. And if not, you can always come and ask. I'm still here for a day.